Thanks to World of Tanks for sponsoring today's video. The largest Jovian moons, known as the Galilean moons, are perhaps some of the most well-known in the entire solar system. However, of the four, there is one that hardly gets mentioned at all. Callisto. Despite the fact it is the third largest moon that we know of, I think the majority of people would be hard-pressed to say any facts about it at all. Is it just a boring world? Or do we simply not know much about it? Actually, we know more than you may first assume, and it is far from boring. I'm Alex McColgan, and you're watching Astrum, and in this video we will take a deep dive into this mysterious moon, explaining what it's like there, what makes it unique, and why it has been one of the most requested topics on this channel. Let's start with where it fits into the Jovian system. Callisto is the third largest moon in the entire solar system, and it's just smaller than Mercury at 4,820 kilometers across. However, while its diameter is only 58 kilometers less than Mercury's, it is only one third of the mass of the planet, meaning it's less dense and its gravity is a lot weaker. It is the second largest of the Galilean moons, and orbits Jupiter much further out than the other three, taking 17 Earth days to do so at an average distance of 1.9 million kilometers. Even at this distance, it is still tidally locked with Jupiter, meaning the same side of Callisto always faces its parent planet. However, it does mean that it is not locked in an orbital resonance with the other three moons, nor do we believe that it ever was. Callisto has a very tenuous atmosphere composed of carbon dioxide, and possibly oxygen too, although oxygen has never actually been detected yet. We know, however, that the atmosphere is so thin that the molecules contained within it do not collide, and theoretically, the atmosphere should be stripped away by atmospheric loss processes in just 4 years. Scientists believe that Callisto's crust is replenishing the lost atmospheric particles through sublimation of carbon dioxide surface ices, evidenced by some interesting surface features. Now, the surface of Callisto is one of the most ancient in the solar system, with evidence placing it at over 4 billion years old. You'll immediately notice the speckled nature of Callisto. Its surface is completely covered with various sized impact craters, more so than any other object we've observed. In fact, it's close to saturation. Any new crater will probably just overlap another one at this point. Without any geological activity, cratering is perhaps the only process that has vastly been impacting Callisto's appearance over its lifetime. Why is Callisto's surface so old compared to a lot of other bodies in the solar system? Well, on geologically active planets like Earth, there are processes that can erase almost all evidence of past impacts. Earth has one of the least cratered surfaces in the solar system because so much happens on its surface. It has weather, water, plants, volcanism, tectonic plates, and human activity. These act together to break apart, wear down, and lift up the ground. Even other Jovian moons like Europa or Io have comparatively fewer craters thanks to tidal forces, which cause geological activity on their surfaces. You see, the first three Galilean moons, Io, Europa, and Ganymede, are locked in what's called a 4-2-1 orbital resonance. These moons exert a gravitational influence on each other. This means that every time Ganymede orbits Jupiter once, Europa orbits twice, and Io orbits 4 times. The orbital resonance exerts tidal forces on these moons, their constant pulling never allowing any of them to get in a perfectly circular orbit. This means the magnitude of the gravitational force acting on the moons increases and decreases as they orbit around Jupiter. This creates tides that stretch the moon's surfaces and also heat up the moon's cores. This doesn't happen with Callisto. Callisto does not show any signs of geological processes such as volcanism or plate tectonics, and so its surface has remained intact after all these years. Limited tidal forces and thus no geological activity impact Callisto in another very unique way. There are no mountains to speak of on its entire surface. When Callisto initially formed at the very beginning of the solar system, it was likely an ocean world that has since frozen over, and apart from the bombardment of meteors, it has stayed exactly the same ever since. So let's have a look at some of these craters, because some of the biggest are truly impressive structures. This is Asgard, the second largest impact crater on Callisto, measuring 1,600 kilometers in diameter. And this is Valhalla, the largest multi-ring impact crater in the entire solar system, with a diameter of 3,800 kilometers. It's these craters that add to the unique appearance of Callisto, as they contain more rings than craters anywhere else. With these craters, the impactor was large enough that it may have completely punctured the thin crust, with it eventually refreezing over in the light patches you see in the middle. Zooming in on these middle regions, you'll notice they have a mottled appearance. There seems to be a big difference in contrast between the bright knobs and the darker plane. These regions are a lot less cratered than the rest of Callisto's surface, which would make sense if the plane truly is a refrozen surface, likely making it 2 billion years younger than the rest of Callisto. The rings are likely fractures in the crust, a concentric failure in the brittle shell of the moon. Interestingly though, within the rings, these bright knobs are still visible. So what are the knobs? Well, they are believed to be the degraded remains of the millions of crater rims from Callisto's past. We don't know exactly why they have degraded so much over time, but perhaps it's due to micrometeor impacts, or simply the ice is slowly sublimating over time. They are brighter than the lower planes because the rocky debris from the meteors and micrometeors will have fallen down the knobs over time, leaving the pure ice exposed at the top. Smaller impact craters are also fascinating due to their uniqueness. Most impact craters are shallower on Callisto compared to our moon. For instance, the Lufen impact structure. It's well over 100 kilometers wide, however, it's only 600 meters deep. This could be because the impactor was breaking apart before it impacted, causing more of a spread out shotgun effect on the surface. Or it could be that the surface has since leveled off from other, larger nearby impacts that have occurred later on. This crater is believed to be over a billion years old at least, yet you can still clearly see the ejecta that has streamed away from the impact, clear evidence of how unchanging this remarkable moon is. With some craters, like Haar crater, there is even a large dome found in the middle. With typical large impacts on other worlds, you will see a few concentric rings and a raised peak in the center. This is very much the case on our moon. However, Callisto has some remarkable examples of large craters where just the opposite happens. Look at Tinder here. Instead of a peak, there is actually a pit in the center. Why does Callisto have such unique craters? It could be due to the fact that Callisto's crust is not just brittle, but pretty thin too, with either soft ice or a salty ocean underneath. Estimates put the crust at 80 to 150 kilometers thick. The Galileo space probe, which spent several years around Jupiter, spent a significant chunk of its time aptly studying the Galilean moons. Galileo found that Jupiter's magnetic field could not penetrate through Callisto, implying there is a highly conductive layer under the surface at least 10 kilometers thick. This couldn't have happened in ice or silicates, unless the ice layer is at least partially molten, or very large temperature gradients can be maintained below the ice to create a conductive effect. Data also suggests that Callisto has a small silicate core at its center, with a radius of about 600 kilometers. Which begs the question, can Callisto be conducive to life like other icy worlds with water mantles under their surfaces? Well, life as we know it requires liquid water and energy to exist. Callisto might have an ocean of liquid water under its surface, but being about 800 million kilometers away from the sun, it barely receives any heat from our star. And the absence of tidal forces doesn't help either, leaving radioactive elements the only source of heat to warm this subsurface ocean, if it exists. And unfortunately, even visiting Callisto won't prove anything. Moons like Europa and Enceladus have vents ejecting water directly from their subsurface oceans, meaning we can investigate habitability prospects without ever going into the oceans themselves. No such vents exist on Callisto, so scientists would have to penetrate the crust in order to find out. All these things combined mean that, unfortunately, scientists think that the environmental conditions necessary for life appear to be less favorable on Callisto than on any other icy worlds. Nevertheless, Callisto shouldn't be ignored. If we ever go to explore the outer solar system, Callisto would make a perfect base. You see, orbiting at a distance of 1.9 million kilometers from Jupiter means that Callisto is located beyond Jupiter's main radiation belt, making its environment thousands of times more conducive to human exploration than its inner moons. Callisto also has a lot of water ice that can be used for propellant production, and of course is the staple to keep humans alive. Separating the hydrogen from oxygen also leaves oxygen for breathing. Callisto's geological stability would make for building structures on the surface relatively worry-free, and the lack of huge mountains or deep trenches means it's faster, easier, and more efficient to travel over. From Callisto, we could better explore the inner Jovian system from a safe distance, or use it as a way station for heading farther into the outer solar system. Lifting off from Callisto would be ideal thanks to its low gravity, and you could get a gravity assist from a close flyby of Jupiter. It's true that this is a futuristic prospect, although if we ever do become a spacefaring species, this is a distinct possibility. Now, while Galileo did an admirable job studying Callisto during its few flybys, there is still a lot of information gaps that need to be filled. With any luck, we'll get that from the European Space Agency's Jupiter Icy Moon Explorer, due to launch in 2022, which will reach the Jovian system by 2030 and will explore Jupiter and three of its largest moons, Ganymede, Callisto, and Europa. ESA has planned several close flybys of Callisto during this mission. This mission might provide more insight into questions like, does it have a subsurface ocean? And if so, does it or can it sustain life? Beyond that, there's also the questions we haven't thought to ask yet. Who knows what more we will still discover about this incredible moon? So, there we have it. Almost everything you could want to know about the fascinating, yet underrated world of Callisto. Let's head to a different world for today's sponsor, the world of tanks. Personally, I am a bit of a gamer, and I do have a bit of a soft spot for shooting games with a tactical element. World of Tanks scratches that itch pretty well, because it doesn't matter how good you are, you can't just go in all guns blazing. Working together as a team is essential, and capturing certain points in the map can give you the best positions to push forward. The 40 maps are really detailed and thought out, plus a lot of effort has been put into the 550 tank models themselves, so that each one has unique characteristics. World of Tanks is a free-to-play game, so give it a try using my link below. With it, you'll get these starting bonuses. Just note that this is limited to new players to the game. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this video about Callisto, you'll probably enjoy learning about other moons in our solar system too, so check out this playlist here. A big thank you as well to my patrons and members who support the channel. If you would like to support too, check out the links in the description below. All the best, and see you next time.